Hello everyone, this is Science Vines and you're watching the audiovisual chapter of class 11th biology. This is the second part of chapter 19, excretory products and their elimination. We are starting off with the function of the tubules. Proximal convoluted tubule or PCT. PCT is lined by simple cuboidal brush border epithelium, which increases the surface area for reabsorption. Nearly all of the essential nutrients and 70-80% of the electrolytes and water are reabsorbed by this segment. PCT also helps to maintain the pH and ionic balance of the body fluids by selective secretion of hydrogen ions, ammonia and potassium ions into the filtrate and by absorption of HCO3- from it. Henle's loop. Reabsorption is minimum in its ascending limb. However, this region plays a significant role in the maintenance of a high osmolarity of medullary interstitial fluid. The descending limb of the loop of Henle is permeable to water, but almost impermeable to electrolytes. This concentrates the filtrate as it moves down. The ascending limb is impermeable to water, but allows transport to electrolytes actively or passively. Therefore, as the concentrated filtrate pass upward, it gets diluted due to passage of electrolytes to the medullary fluid. Now, the distal convoluted tubule or DCT. Conditional reabsorption of sodium, ion and water take place in this segment. DCT is also capable of reabsorption of HCO3- and selective secretion of hydrogen and potassium ions and ammonia to maintain the pH and sodium-potassium balance in blood. Now, collecting duct. This long duct extends from the cortex of kidney to the inner parts of the medulla. Large amounts of the water could be reabsorbed from this region to produce a concentrated urine. This segment allows passage of small amount of urea into the medullary interstitium to keep up the osmolarity. It also plays a role in the maintenance of pH and ionic balance of blood by the selective secretion of H+ and K+ ions. Mechanisms of concentration of the filtrate. Mammals have the ability to produce a concentrated urine. The Henle's loop and vasa recta plays a significant role in this. The flow of filtrate in the two limbs of Henle's loop is in opposite direction and thus forms a counter current. The flow of blood through the two limbs of vasa recta also in a countercurrent pattern. The proximity between the Henle's loop and vasa recta as well as the countercurrent in them helping in maintaining and increasing osmolarity towards the inner medullary interstitium, that is from 300 milliosmium mole per liter in the cortex to about 1200 milliosmole per liter in the inner medulla. This gradient is mainly caused by NaCl in urea. NaCl is transported by the ascending limb of loop of Henle, which is exchanged with the descending limb of vasa recta. NaCl is returned to the interstitium by the ascending portion of the vasa recta. Similarly, small amount of urea enter the thin segment of ascending loop of Henle, which is transported back to the interstitium by the collecting tubule. The above described transport of substances facilitated by the special arrangement of Henle's loop and vasa recta is called countercurrent mechanism. This mechanism helps to maintain a concentration gradient in the medullary interstitium. Presence of such interstitial gradient helps in an easy passage of water from the collecting duct tubule, thereby concentrating the filtrate or urine. Human kidneys can produce urine nearly 4 times concentrated than the initial filtrate formed. Regulation of kidney function. The functioning of the kidney is efficiently monitored and regulated by hormonal feedback mechanisms involving the hypothalamus, JGA, and to a certain extent the heart. Osmoreceptors in the body are activated by changes in blood volume, body fluid volume and ionic concentration. An excessive loss of fluid from the body can activate these receptors, which stimulate the hypothalamus to release antidiuretic hormone ADH or vasopressin from the neurohypophysis. ADH facilitates water reabsorption from latter parts of the tubule, thereby preventing diuresis. An increase in body fluid volume can switch off the osmoreceptors and suppress the ADH release to complete the feedback. ADH can also affect the kidney function by its constrictory effects on blood vessels. This causes an increase in blood pressure. An increase in blood pressure can increase the glomerular blood flow and thereby the GFR. The JGA plays a complex regulatory role. A fall in glomerular blood flow or glomerular blood pressure, GFR, can activate the JG cell to release renin, which converts angiotensin in blood to angiotensin 1 and further to angiotensin 2. Angiotensin 2, being a powerful vasoconstrictor, increases the glomerular blood pressure and thereby GFR. Angiotensin 2 also activates the adrenal cortex to release aldosterone. Aldosterone causes reabsorption and Na+ and water from the distal parts of the tubule. This also leads to an increase in blood pressure and GFR. This complex mechanism is generally known as the renin-angiotensin mechanism. An increase in blood flow to the atria of heart can cause the release of atrial natriuretic factor, or ANF. ANF can cause vasodilation, dilation of blood vessels, and thereby decrease the blood pressure. ANF mechanism therefore act as a check on the renin-angiotensin mechanism. Now the micturition. Urine found by the nephrons is ultimately carried to the urinary bladder, where it is stored till a voluntary signal is given by the central nervous system, or CNS. This signal is initiated by the stretching of the urinary bladder as it gets filled with urine. In response, the stress receptors on the walls of the bladder send signals to the CNS. The CNS passes on motor messages to initiate the contraction of smooth muscles of the bladder and simultaneous relaxation of the urethral sphincter, causing the release of urine. The process of release of urine is called micturition, and the neural mechanisms causing it is called the micturition reflex. An adult human excretes on an average 1 to 1.5 liters of urine per day. The urine formed is a light yellow colored watery fluid which is slightly acidic, pH 6, and has a characteristic odor. On an average, 25 to 30 gram of urea is excreted out per day. Various conditions can affect the characteristics of the urine. Analysis of urine helps in clinical diagnosis of many metabolic disorders as well as the malfunctions of the kidney. For example, presence of glucosuria and ketone bodies, ketonuria, in urine are indicative of diabetes mellitus. Role of other organs in excretion. Other than the kidneys, lungs, liver and skin also help in elimination of excretory waste. Our lungs remove large amount of CO2, approximately 200 ml per minute, and also significant quantities of water every day. Liver, the largest gland in our body, secretes bile-containing substances like bilirubin, biliverdin, cholesterol, degraded steroid hormones, vitamins and drugs. Most of these substances ultimately pass out along with digestive waste. The sweat and sebaceous glands in the skin can eliminate certain substances through their secretions. Sweat produced by the sweat gland is a watery fluid containing NaCl, small amounts of urea, lactic acid, etc. Though the primary function of the sweat is to facilitate the cooling effect on the body surface, it also helps in the removal of some of the waste mentioned above. Sebaceous glands eliminate certain substances like sterols, hydrocarbons and waxes through sebum. This secretion provides a protective oily covering for the skin. Do you know that small amounts of nitrogenous waste could be eliminated through saliva too? Yes, they do. Disorders of the excretory system. Malfunctioning of kidneys can lead to accumulation of urea in blood. A condition called uremia, which is highly harmful and may lead to kidney failure. In such patients, urea can be removed by the process called hemodialysis. During the process of hemodialysis, the blood drained from the convenient artery is pumped into a dialyzing unit called artificial kidney. Blood drained from a convenient artery is pumped into a dialyzing unit after adding an anticoagulant like heparin. The unit contains a coiled cellophane tube surrounded by a fluid or dialyzing fluid having the same composition as that of plasma except the nitrogenous waste. The porous cellophane membrane of the tube allows the passage of molecules based on concentration gradient. As nitrogenous waste are absent in the dialyzing fluid, these substances freely move out, thereby clearing the blood. The cleared blood is pumped back to the body through a vein after adding antiheparin to it. This method is a boon for thousands of uremic patients all over the world. Kidney transplantation is the ultimate method in the correction of acute renal failures or kidney failure. A functioning kidney is used in transplantation from a donor, preferably a close relative, to minimize its chances of rejection by the immune system of the host. Modern clinical procedures have increased the success rate of such a complicated technique. Renal calculi, stone or insoluble mass of crystallized salts, oxalates, etc., formed within the kidney. Glomerulonephritis, inflammation of glomeruli of kidney. Here we end the second part of the chapter 19, excretory products and their elimination. To watch more such videos, to subscribe the channel and press the bell icon so you don't miss any video. And if you want us to create more such videos on any other book or subject, do mention in the comment section please. Like and share the video to keep us motivated to create such content. Thank you for watching the video. Bye bye. Love.